what the, I guess, what the usage rates and stuff on that one. They'll work like you're in advance.
I was scared. I bet most of our military parts are made at home. That's how we won World War II. We already had factories ready. We could kick that stuff out faster than they could shoot it. Yeah, but they were there and the people were there. It wouldn't have been able to get going.
Welcome to Christian Valley this morning. Good to see each of you here. Let's stand and praise God through song.
Amazing grace. This is a faith. I raise a hallelujah. storm. Out of the louder, gonna hear my praises roar. From the ashes, hope will arise. Then is defeated, he is alive.
All of
show you my weakness, failures and flaws. When you see the law, you still call me friend. He's the God of the mountain, he's the God of the
than a child of God with a big smile on their face. Amen? Let's see them. Let's see them. There we go. There we go. Thank you. Well, last Sunday evening, we were having our small group over at Ray and Laura's house, and we were talking about the one common the one thing that all Christians worldwide have in common, the one thing that we all have in common, if you claim to be a Christian, you have to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to believe that he's the Savior of the world. You have to not only believe it, but you have to love him and follow him. Okay, you got to believe, love, and follow. You have to be a part of that. If you are a Christian, that is a common denominator among all Christians worldwide. That's what it means to be a Christian, is to be a believer in God, to be loved and to love him and to be devoted to him. But the tie that binds us together as Christians, as brothers and sisters in Christ, that tie that binds us together is found in the book of John, chapter 15, and I want to read that to you this morning. There in John 15, chapter 12, it says this: "My command is this, Love each other as I have loved you. Greater love Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. Now you think about that for a minute, and that is what our Lord and Savior did on the cross at Calvary, was the absolute supreme example of no one having greater love than anyone else. That is the top. That's where it starts at. So the tie that binds us together is the love that we have for one another. And not just one another as in brothers and sisters in Christ. It means the love that you have for your fellow man. Okay? Because if you don't love your fellow man, you don't want to take that message of the Lord Jesus to them. And that is our responsibility as Christians. That is how we show our Lord and Savior that we love him back, is to take his word and share it with those around us. I know not long ago we were talking about if you have someone in your family, someone close to you, someone that you love, it's your responsibility to take that message to them. Because if you don't, who will? Who cares more about them? Certainly, it's you. It's you. So as we prepare to come around the Lord's table today, think about that great sacrifice that was made on that cross of Calvary. Think about how immense that was, and that now, because of that, we have an opportunity to share in glory with the Lord. We have an opportunity to see our loved ones who's passed on again. Amen. So as a gentleman come forward, I want you to think about your relationship with God. Think about what he did for you, and think about what you are going to do for him. Amen? Let's bow our heads. God Almighty, we're so thankful for the love that you have shown us. We just ask, Father, that you give us the courage that we in turn can share your love with someone else, another brother and sister in Christ, show them encouragement. Give them a beautiful smile to look at. These things, Father, as we prepare to remember this sacrifice, that your shed blood, your body as it was hung upon that cruel cross of Calvary, you did that for us. We can't thank you enough. In our Lord and Savior's most precious and beautiful name, amen. Thank you.
just a second. Got a lot going on, and I do know it's a holiday weekend, but we've had a good summer. Just really been good here. Attendance has been good. We've had a lot going on, but it's time to kind of crank back up on some things.
Appreciate you, Jeffrey.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
And let me just say, I think we're clear on this, but we're not doing children's birthday. So our kids are just going to stay out here and listen to you. Okay?
Wonderful. They're going to love this, I tell you what. First of all, every morning we come and we do service, this worship team literally cracks my heart open and just so prepares me to hear God's word. And we just don't show them enough appreciation. So if we could, just give them one more big round of applause. They did amazing this morning. So as a pastor, over the last 20 years, I've avoided, whenever I could, talking about politics. Partly because politics is of the world, and we're called to be in the world, but not a part of it. But mostly because politics really don't do anything but completely divide people. And if you guys have been following what's going on in our political season this, you know, at this time, the division is crazy. You know, it's important to understand what politics actually means. So I put the definition up for what politics is. It's a two-part word, poly, meaning many or multiple, And ticks, of course, being blood-sucking animals. So politics is many blood-sucking animals. So with that in mind, after following along this political season like a good little citizen, I've come to realize something. I have absolutely no idea what any of our candidates actually believe in. Between the mudslinging and the name-calling, nobody's really painted me a really good picture. And it's also become really apparent that none of them have read Exodus 20:16, "Thou shalt not give false testimony against your brother or neighbor." So it kind of got me thinking. If these yahoos running for office are spending hundreds of millions of dollars to win your vote, and I still don't know what they stand for or what they believe in, it got me wondering how many people in our world as Christians don't know what we believe in or what we stand for. So I wanted to take some time and talk about that, because in 1 Peter 3:15 says, "But in your hearts revere Christ as Lord, always being prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for your hope that you have." So it's important that we know what we believe in and why we believe in it. So if you don't mind, let's start with a quick prayer. Father God, I ask that you join us here today. I ask that you fill this room with your Holy Spirit. I ask that you open our heart up to the message that we're about to hear, and I pray this in your holy and precious name. Amen. So Friday or so, I realized that tomorrow is Labor Day. Summer completely escaped me, and as I was writing this talk, I noticed that it has 38 Bible verses. And the one group in this room that we don't celebrate enough is the people in the back corner that are here every week running our slides, running our online service. And if we could, let's give them a quick round of applause and thank them for what they do. But I wanted to give them a gift too. I didn't want them to end up with carpal tunnel syndrome, clicking the button 38 times as we work through this. So we went ahead and I went and put all of the verses and all of the points on the handouts. If you didn't get one when you came in today, please take one. And in the spirit of Labor Day, nobody has to take notes now. So we got that. So before we talk about what we believe as a church, I wanted to start by taking a look at some of the common misconceptions that the world and Christians have about our faith. Now, the first misconception is salvation by works. Christians believe that they can earn their way to heaven through good deeds alone. And we know the truth that salvation is by grace through faith, not by works. Ephesians 2:8 and 9, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and it is not of yourself, it is a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast." Now, I was raised in a different organized religion that believed in works. They didn't necessarily say it, but they in a way taught it, and they did it by calling them sacraments, and you had to go through certain sacraments throughout your life to prepare you to enter, you know, to enter heaven. And we know that's not true, that this was a gift from God, and it's not something that we can earn. It's something that can be only freely given to us. Another common misconception is the Trinity as three gods. Christians worship three separate gods, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Matthew 28:19, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit." I think the Trinity is probably one of the most difficult things for a Christian to really, truly understand in their heart. Okay? We teach it so many different ways. I mean, I was taught when I was young that I'm a man as a first person. I might be a husband in the second person. I might be a father in a third person. But really, that's not what our Trinity is. Our Trinity is so much greater than that. And don't feel bad about having a hard time understanding the idea of a triune God when we're looking at a person that spoke the world into existence. I don't think it was truly meant for us to be able to understand as well as he did. But our God exists in three separate entities, but is truly one God. This is one that I really appreciate, and it's Christianity opposes science. Christianity is inherently anti-science. I got a couple of Bible verses on there, but the one that hits me the most is forever the world was thought of to be flat. But Isaiah 40:22 says, he sits enthroned upon the circles of the earth, and it's his people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. Scripture told us that our earth was round way before science ever found a way to prove that it's true. So we see that in so many different places in Scripture where it's proving to be more and more, helping to prove science more and more. Next one, Christians believe that they are better than others, that they are morally superior. But Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. When I think of this by this misconception, it kind of makes me smile. By show of hands, and you don't have to raise them high for everybody to see, but who appreciates an episode of The Simpsons every once in a while? Okay? That's what I like to believe grace is for, to forgive us for doing that. But I think back to an episode of The Simpsons where Ned Flanders' wife was missing. And everybody thought that he might have killed her. So they asked him one day, where's your wife, Ned? And his reply was, well, she went off to Bible camp to learn how to be more judgmental. The truth is, we've given people, in many ways, that belief, because we take our beliefs in Scripture and our beliefs in the Ten Commandments and in the law, and we judge other people by those things. And the truth is, if they're not believers in God, it's not theirs to believe it. We're called to share it with them, not to impose it on them. So we can help alleviate that misunderstanding by showing more grace when we deal with non-believers. All Christians interpret the Bible the same way. All Christians have a uniform understanding of the Bible. I look at that one and I think, okay, so Jesus spent most of his time teaching in parables and similes. He left it open for us to understand. He left it open for us to interpret, and he led us. Paul's letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and the unstable people will distort as they do other scriptures to their own destruction. In Acts 17:11, now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. We don't always see things identical, but that's what constant study, constant reading, and meditation to help develop that understanding. But people view it different ways. Another misconception, faith means believing without evidence. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. I've been asked so many times if I'm a man of faith. And my answer has always been, I'm not a man of faith, I'm a man of belief. I have seen God work so many ways, so many times in my life, that the evidence to me is seen. Okay? Do I have faith? Yes, I have faith. But I believe in my heart the truth of Scripture. And some people just don't get there. And I'm sorry, I got a really dry mouth all of a sudden. I'm gonna actually just step right into the next one. I apologize. Christianity is just about the rules and restrictions. The misunderstanding, Christianity is focused on following a set of rules to avoid punishment. John 15:10-11, if you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, and just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love, I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. We taught a class once when I was a new Christian that talked about the law and the commandments and how a lot of people view the commandments and God's law as a fence to keep us in, to constrain us. But the way we taught it was, no, that it, there is a fence, but it's a fence to keep sin out. Okay? The Ten Commandments, in a nutshell, are a guideline of relationships, ways to maintain relationships both with God and other people. They're not rules about don't do this, don't do that. It's how do you protect relationships. You protect relationships by being honest. You protect relationships by not coveting, by not stealing, by not bearing false witness. So they're not so much rules to restrict us as much as they are to protect us. So let's take a look at some of the things that our church does believe in. I asked Pastor Mitch to provide me to give me a copy of our church's belief statement. So I just broke it down with some biblical references. The creation of the world and mankind. As a church, we believe that God created the world and then God created mankind. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Genesis 1:26 and 27. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness," so that God created mankind in his own image. We believe in the creation through God. The Trinity, we've already discussed. We believe that God exists in three persons, but as a single Godhead. The person and the works of Jesus Christ. The belief is that we believe Jesus Christ was God in the flesh, the Son of God, who was born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, and was crucified on a cross for our sins. John 1:14, the world became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And Isaiah 7:14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. The resurrection, ascension, and the second coming of Christ. We believe that Jesus won victory over death by rising from the grave, ascending into heaven, and he will return. Matthew 28:6, he is not here, he is risen. Just as he said, the story of the resurrection, ascension, and the coming back of Christ is the cornerstone of our belief. Acts 1:9 through 11, after he said this, he was taken up before our very eyes, and a cloud hid him from our sight. The same Jesus who has been taken away from you into heaven will come back in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven. The Bible is the inspired word of God. We believe that the Bible, although written by men, is inspired word of God. We base all of our decisions on what the Bible says. 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. I love the acronym Bible, Basic Instructions Before Leaving Earth. It is a guideline and a guidebook to live our entire life, and I do believe that it is fully inspired and breathed by God. Salvation in Jesus Christ. We believe the eternal life is available only by grace of God through the blood of Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2:8 through 9. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourself. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no man can boast. I listed this verse twice because it salvation through grace and faith is so important that we realize that there's nothing we can do. We can't earn it. We can't claim it. It has to be freely given to us. Repentance, confession, and baptism. We believe that the Bible teaches that we should repent of our sins, confess publicly that Jesus is Christ, and be baptized. Acts 2:38, and Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, for forgiveness of your sins, and that you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." When I was first baptized, I recall the pastor saying, one of the reasons that we are baptized is because it's one of the very few things that we can do that Jesus did, which I thought always kind of funny when they said that, because when John challenged Jesus saying, you should baptize me. Jesus' reply, no, it needs to be done this way. You have to baptize me. And I wonder sometimes in my heart if that was the connection he was trying to make with us. And in the only way that we can truly understand and relate to what he did is the symbolism of baptism, of dying to our sin and being reborn in the Holy Spirit. Baptism by immersion. We believe in the New Testament biblical example of baptism was immersion, and that anyone who desires to follow Jesus should have the same desire to be immersed. And it's that public declaration, in my opinion, that's so important in that baptism. And I think that's why in most Christian denominations, baptism cannot happen as an infant because they're unable to proclaim that. That is more of a dedication ceremony, and that in order to truly recognize the importance of baptism, you have to understand the fact that you are dying to sin and being born again in Him. The church is the body of Christ. We believe that the church was established after the ascension of Jesus to heaven, and that we represent Jesus in everything that we do. Ephesians 1, 2-23, and God placed all things under his feet and appointed to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fulfillment of him who fills everything in every way. Judgment and eternity. We believe that all people will be judged after earthly death, and that those who have accepted God's plan of salvation and follow Jesus will spend eternity in his heavenly presence, while the unsaved will spend eternity separated from God in hell. I've always viewed hell as nothing more than the separation of man and God. If God was not a part of my life, I would be living in it today. That separation is what we're referring here. Not so much the lake of fire as the simile, but I would equate that lake of fire as the separation from God. So we've talked about the misconceptions and discussed our church's belief. Now it's up to you to go out into the world to destroy those misconceptions by sharing your faith and belief with everyone you meet. So my takeaway is Colossians 3:17. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. For those of you that are worried about what's going to happen this November, I want to remind you of one thing. God used the good kings, and God used the bad kings in order to prepare us for the real king. So no matter what happens this November, God's will be fulfilled. We close with a prayer. Father God, I thank you for the word that you've given us in Scripture. I thank you for the examples that you've given us in how you lived your life and how we should live our life. I ask, Father God, that you bless each and every one of us as we go out this week and help us to share our knowledge of you, our beliefs in you, and help clear up the misconceptions and strengthen our faith. And I pray this, Jesus, in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Stand with us this morning.
Mountain and the mountain will
So that was fine earlier, right? And now it's not. I don't know. I don't know. I have no clue. Which gets me into here's a